Not far from the city of Inverness, in the town of Beauly, there stands the weathered remains of an old priory. This priory was founded in 1230 by the monks of the Vasculian order. These French Catholic monks would spend their whole lives in small cells focused on prayer and meditation. They were forbidden from rearing livestock and cultivating crops. Instead, they would live on a very meager subsidy from the Catholic Church. These conditions would lead to malnutrition, starvation, and eventually the death of many monks in their cold, dark cells. For 300 years, the monks lived and died in the Great Priory of Beauly, but it was around that time that the Valiscolian order ended. The Great Priory was now empty, as no one dared to intrude on the hallowed ground, and by the early 18th century, it was known to be a menacing and mysterious place. Unearthly sights and sounds were to be heard coming from the priory at night. It was said that anyone who ventured into the cold churchyard or the dust-filled burial chambers were never seen again. There was some evil within the priory, but what form did this dark presence take? The tale of the Grey Paw. There was once a young tailor who lived in the village of Beauly. He, of course, had heard all the mysterious tales of the abandoned priory. People disappearing, the nightly howls, and ghostly apparitions. He was not a believer in such magical tales. He put it all down to superstitious nonsense. One night, while talking with some of the other villagers, the tailor boldly stated that he had no fear of the priory, and would happily prove that there was no supernatural presence within the old building. He made a wager that he would go to the priory late at night and sew a pair of hose, all the while sitting in the haunted crypt. With the various deals made, the tailor went to the priory. All alone, he crept through the churchyard and towards the great wooden doors. Inside, he found the place to be abandoned and dusty. The air was cold, and there was not a sound to be heard as he passed the empty stone cells of the monks. In the crypt, he found a stool and lit a candle. Laying out his needles and thread, the tailor began to work. The tailor sat in the crypt, undisturbed for the first few hours. He had made good work on sewing the hose, and thought that the wager was his. But at the dead hour of midnight, a large ghastly head emerged from a tomb, aimed its skeletal features at the tailor, and said,
"Look at the old grey cow. That is without food, tailor."
The tailor, with no hint of fear, simply replied, "I see this, and I sew that." While he spoke, there was no movement from the spectral head, but when he drew breath, the skeletal form rose higher. As the neck emerged, the spectre said,
"A long, grizzled, weazened, that is without food, tailor."
The tailor still continued to sew, but now a grim and cold fear had begun to force its way into his thoughts. He answered, "I see it, my son. I see it, my son. I see that, and I sew this just now." As he spoke, he drew out his words to their utmost length, but at last, when his voice had failed him, he inhaled a long, deep breath. The monster rose once more. Now with its full ribcage out of the tomb, it gestured a clawed arm to the tailor and said,
"A long grey arm, that is without flesh or food, tailor."
The poor man, now trembling as the fear encased him, continued with his needle, "I see it, my son. I see it, my son. I see that, and I sew this just now," he repeated. Then he drew another agonizing breath as the evil spectre stepped out of the tomb. The tailor could now see its full, incorporeal form. A living skeleton, its bones cleansed of flesh. A dark aura emitted from the creature as it said,
"A long, crooked shank that is without meat, tailor."
The wraith now stretched its fleshless and foodless arm in the direction of the terrified man and spoke again,
"A long grey paw, without blood or flesh or muscles or meat, tailor.
The tailor was nearing the end of his task. For one last time, he turned to the skeletal ghost and said, I see it, my son. I see it, my son. I see that and I saw this just now. Once again, the tailor held his breath for as long as possible. He only had a few stitches left to go. With this breath, the creature extended its bony, claw-like fingers and said,
A big grey claw that is without meat, tailor.
And at that moment, the last stitch was sewn. The horrified tailor sprang to the door, and not a moment too soon, as the great claw of the spectre lunged towards him, catching the doorpost and the back of the poor tailor's leg. The tailor, with all haste, ran past the monk's cells, through the dusty doors, out into the churchyard, and all the way home. Never did he dare return to the great priory of Beauly. It is still said to this day that the mark of the ghostly hand remains on the crypt door. This tale was once quite well known in the Highlands. It was said to be told in dark winter nights, and on many occasions the teller of the tale would move its location to a local castle or church to gain a more captive audience. Sadly, like many of the old tales, in recent years, this one has sunk into some obscurity. This version of the tale comes from John Gregerson Campbell, a collector of Scottish folklore. He recorded the tale in a book released in 1902 called Witchcraft and the Second Sight in the Highlands and Islands. Another version of the tale comes from the Cathedral of Iona, which sits on a small island in the west coast of Scotland. In this cathedral, there was a similar group of monks, but this group had their own tailor who lived within the cathedral. The tailor would stay in a small, cramped room they called the tailor's nook. The monks kept the poor man busy day and night. When he eventually got the opportunity for some quick rest, his dreams were haunted by the most grotesque nightmares. It was during these nightmares that the tailor was besieged by a skeletal phantom. Each night, more of the beast would appear in his dreams, until one morning he awoke to find words carved into the wall above his bed. They said, A big grey claw, that is without meat, tailor. Even with these multiple iterations of the tale, we never learn too much about the spectre. We can make a good guess at its intentions, but its background is a complete mystery. As for its future, it's possible that the menacing skeletal figure still haunts the priory crypt. Perhaps it lays entombed, waiting for one final breath to give it life. Thank you for listening.